Texas gardener. I'm Tom Spencer. In recent years, we found that we can grow many types of citrus. And today, Merrideth Jiles from The Great Outdoors explains how to do it and the best cold hardy ones to pick. On tour, let's visit with Randy Case, who created garden spaces out of a typical yard.
When master gardener Randy Case updated his 1950s home, he gave it a new look outside, too.
I bought the house in September of 2004, and I was looking for a small house with a big yard. That's what I, because I love gardening. And it was just a huge St. Augustine expanse. That's all it was. I mean, it had a few trees, large trees, one in the front, one in the back, actually. And other than that, there was nothing, just some really healthy grass.
Randy focused on the front yard and its slope once he tackled updates inside.
A friend had given me a bunch of stones. He had some extra from a wall that he had built. And I had them stacked around. I moved them all over the place, and they weigh a ton. I moved them everywhere. And finally, one day, I just thought, I think I'll just cut this back and build a wall here. And that's why I did it.
Above the wall, anchoring tall plants frame a cove near the house. On the other side, he renovated a spot that was challenged by borders of reflected heat. Randy wanted privacy for the front window, but questioned how to handle the narrow space.
I just had this idea one day to build those boxes. And I couldn't figure out a design, and then I saw a photo of the Guggenheim Museum with the way it's small at the bottom and it goes up. And I wish I could have made them round like that or fluid lines, but you know, that was what prompted me to do that.
He didn't neglect the driveway and side yard either, partly because his list of plants to try was getting longer by the minute.
I like the idea too of when you see a house that has a lot of greenery in the front yard, and all you can really see usually is maybe the roof or the front door. To me, that gives it mystery. You know, like I look at that house and I think, what's back there? You know, I just want to know. And so that's another thing that I'm going for. I just like that idea.
It wasn't until 2009 that he got serious about the backyard.
You know, I had some ideas, but that's another thing. I'm a real perfectionist. And I can look at someone else's yard and tell them exactly what to do. You know, it's just, I see it and I'm like, okay, this should be this way and this should be this way. But in my own yard, I was just, for several months, I was just frozen because I wanted it to be perfect. And I had a heck of a time figuring it out, really. But I would write stuff down, and I was writing down, I wanted a really large patio that went the entire length of the house. And I just had these ideas, and then one day it just sort of gelled, and I got the metal edging and laid it all out. I put it all together and laid it out several different times and tried different shapes, you know, until I came up with one that I really liked. And then it really just kind of evolved on its own. I started with the patio. That was the first thing I did. And then from there, it just all sort of came together, you know. It just sort of one thing after another, and eventually it all kind of fell into place. My goal on all of that really was to get rid of the St. Augustine grass. It was kind of a shame. I mean, I moved in here and the grass, it was really pretty and healthy, you know. But I would look at it and think, I don't want this. You know, I don't want grass. It wastes so much water.
For now, he's kept some grass, but management techniques keep it content on limited water. In its restricted use, the lawn contributes to the other textural diversity Randy uses to define spaces and show off his plants. He also defines spaces by pairing and layering plants, avoiding strict homogeneous rows.
I'm colorblind, and so really bold colors and textures, you know, is what I can see more clearly. So I don't really usually go for subtle.
The very thought of you makes my heart sing like an April breeze climb the wings of spring.
You know, they tell you in gardening that you don't want to get too many different varieties because it'll look messy and junky. And I think if you want them, do it. You know, it's your yard and you should just do what you want. I mean, there are the rules, and I think the rules are there for a reason, and that there's a lot of wisdom behind those rules. But I also think that you can bend the rules or break them, you know, for your own, to suit your own tastes. And I do that a lot.
With pots and salvage finds, Randy adds further dimension, definition, and discovery. As much as he loves collecting old furniture and props, at first he wasn't sure what to do with one must-have from Craigslist.
One day I just leaned it against the fence over there, and I noticed that when I leaned it against the fence, that it looked like it opened up into the next yard. The trunk of my tree matched up with the top of the tree on the other side of the fence in several points in the yard, and so I just thought that was so neat, so I just went ahead and put it up there. It also brings a little light. That was a dark area because it's a shady spot, and when I put the mirror in, it brightened it up quite a bit.
As a gardener on an adventure that never ends, Randy really only has two rules.
I guess my philosophy on gardening is that in this climate, anything that wants to thrive in this climate has a place in my yard. I mean, you know, there's some things, I don't really baby anything. I'll plant it and try it, and if it does well, then it can stay, and I'll plant more of them if it really thrives. But if it dies, then I just, you know, next thing. You know, there's plenty of things to choose from here. And I think that, you know, you need to put your personal touch on your yard and do what makes you happy.
All right, now we're going to talk about one of the most popular topics in gardening these days, at least here in Central Texas, and that is growing citrus plants, which is a new phenomenon to us, relatively new phenomenon. And I'm joined by Merrideth Jiles from The Great Outdoors. It's great to have you with us.
Great to be here, Tom.
Well, it's always fun to have you on the program. Great Outdoors is a wonderful garden center, and you've been carrying a lot of citrus for a while now. It's become one of the many specialties of the house, right?
Yeah, we've definitely been in citrus trees as long as I've been at the nursery. So.
Yeah, and it's changed a lot. I remember 20 years ago here in Austin, we would never recommend citrus in the ground, but times have changed, if not the climate.
Definitely, yeah. You know, like you say, it was always the rule of thumb before, well, you can't do them in the ground. Well, maybe if you want to try, but, you know, as a nurseryman, I'm not supposed to recommend it. Mm-hmm. But now we've actually seen the city add them to the Grow Green Guide, so
right.
It's coming much more popular to try to grow citrus in the ground. It's just really a matter of making sure we pick the right variety.
And we're going to be talking about some really good varieties, and you've brought some to show. But let's talk about the situation that some gardeners are facing right now, because a lot of people have planted citrus over the past few years, and then along comes this past winter, which actually got pretty cold for the first time in almost two decades.
Yeah. Yeah, and I think all of them have given me a call at the nursery already. So yes, definitely we did get a lot of damage this year, and at this point we should really be able to see the extent of the damage. It was a little cool still earlier on, but by now the soil should have warmed up to a point where we should see the growth and see how much damage we have. I think it's really going to depend a lot on how close to town you are, how protected your plant was, how mm-hmm. established it was.
Right.
A lot of those factors are going to go into play, but basically, you know, if you see nice new green growth coming from an area and brown stick above that, the brown stick's probably not coming back.
Right. And one thing to be on the lookout for, too, and we've talked about this, is that almost all citrus plants are grafted.
Yes, yes.
And if it's died to the ground, but things are coming up from the ground, probably not the plant you want.
Exactly, yes. Most citrus is grafted on the trifoliate orange, which is a native plant, extremely hardy, but not very desirable.
Mm-hmm.
And so they use that rootstock to grow a desirable plant. But yes, if all you see is green little fluff coming up from the ground level, that's probably your rootstock, and you probably have lost everything above that. Now, if you have some of that coming up from the ground, but also green growth coming up higher, just cut the green growth at the ground down and leave your tree. But
right.
If all you see is coming up from the ground, unfortunately, you probably lost the tree. So.
And you probably, it depends. Some people like the trifoliate orange. If you like thorns, go for it. That's my recommendation.
If you like a giant mass of thorns in your yard, then it's a great plant.
Okay, well, let's talk about what people should be doing to their citrus right now. What's the proper time to start fertilizing? And let's tackle that one first, and we'll talk about pruning.
Okay. Well, now is exactly the time to start fertilizing. Citrus are subtropical plants. They're really not going to grow until we have some warm air temperatures and soil temperatures. So we're just getting into that time. So now is the time to start. Generally, it's accepted you fertilize from April through October, and I would agree with that if you're doing a liquid fertilizer. I personally like to do a slow-release organic fertilizer.
Okay.
And so I stop my fertilizing late August, early September, knowing that that is going to break down and feed through about the October
timeframe. Okay, now let's talk about the ratio that you use. I've always heard that citrus like nitrogen. Mm-hmm. What's the ratio that you like?
I personally like about a 6-2-4 fertilizer, and there's one in particular that we do sell at the Great Outdoors that I really like because it actually also has a little bit of iron, or sorry, not iron, sulfur mixed in with it. And I think that sulfur also helps kind of buffer the alkalinity of our soil and water.
Okay. All right. So 6-2-4
is what 6-2-4, a higher nitrogen kind of formula.
Yeah. I've always used kind of a blend of different things and giving them, I have tried iron supplements during the course of the year as well. Sometimes you get a little bit that chlorosis in the leaves, and it seems like liquid seaweed with iron, it's a good thing to occasionally add in.
Oh, absolutely. I can't say enough good stuff about liquid seaweed. And that's why I kind of like that 6-2-4 with the sulfur, because that sulfur helps kind of unlock some of the iron that is in our soil.
Okay. Now let's talk about pruning. Unlike a lot of other fruit trees, it's not absolutely necessary to prune citrus, is it?
No. Pruning on citrus is really done more to control height and for the health of the plant. Obviously, if you had dying branches or cross branches that are rubbing together, could be the entry point for disease or insects. You want to take care of that kind of thing, but they don't need to be heavily pruned to be able to produce like some of the more temperate fruits are.
Okay, well, you've brought some plants, and I wanted to show people some of these cool varieties, and you carry these at the Great Outdoors.
Absolutely.
The first one we're going to be talking about is a variety of lemon called Eureka, and we can see that it's in bloom right now. Beautiful citrus blossoms, and I'm sure heavenly fragrant, right?
Yes, very, very fragrant. That's one of the most wonderful smells in the garden, I think, is that,
absolutely, that
smell of citrus in bloom. The Eureka is a nice, large lemon, you know, suitable for slicing and juicing. Mm-hmm. Moderately cold hardy. I think it could be done in the ground. Again, closer to town, I wouldn't try it a little farther out.
In a sheltered area up against the house on the south side.
Yeah, all those little caveats we like to throw in.
Right. So the Eureka lemon, and how big a plant does this get to be if you just let it go?
Most citrus trees are probably, if you just let them go, probably around 12 to 15 feet, which is why I do recommend some pruning just for height to be able to control it.
Right.
But generally in that 12 to 15 foot range.
Okay. Well, you brought another one that looks perfect for container gardening.
Exactly.
And a lot of citrus, and that's a great way to grow citrus still in Central Texas is in containers. And this is a little variegated calamondin, is that right?
Yes, the variegated calamondin. It's a type of orange, but it's not your traditional large navel type orange, very small fruit. Really, I think it's just a great example of how beautiful a citrus tree can be as a potted plant.
Yeah, tight form.
Yeah, tight form, great for a container. A lot of people want a fragrant plant, you know, for their patio or something like that, and a lot of our fragrant plants don't bloom for a long period of time, and this would be another way to get some fragrance in the garden.
The next plant that we have is a Meyer's lemon, and these are among the most popular varieties of lemons. Are these a good choice for Austin?
Yes, the Meyer's lemon is a great one for Austin. You know, relatively cold hardy, good sized fruit for making juice or anything like that. And just pretty close to a grocery store lemon.
I like the form on this one too. This particular plant has a nice kind of globe round shape.
Yeah.
Will it kind of maintain that, do you think, as it grows, or is it going to get a little rangier?
A little rangier, but, you know, when we think of a citrus tree, I really almost like to think of it more as a citrus bush.
Sure.
They branch low. They're very full.
Right.
So.
And then a little bit of deadheading along the edge will keep it in that shape.
Yeah.
Okay. And then the very last one, we have a thornless Mexican lime. Now, how's that different from the store-bought limes that we typically buy here in the United States?
Well, the Mexican lime is a small lime, kind of akin to the key lime. In fact, some people argue that the key lime and the Mexican lime are the same. Others will argue that it's very different. But it's a very small lime, maybe the size of a golf ball, perfect for slicing up for your cerveza or something like that, or making juices for pie. But not a large type lime that you would typically see in a grocery store.
Okay, but a cold hardiness on this one?
It is one of the more cold hardy limes. Limes in the big picture are not one of the more cold hardy citrus, but I have had these make it, so.
Okay, so we have a variety of different choices here, and they can find a lot more at the Great Outdoors.
Absolutely.
And I hope people will come down and avail themselves. I know that throughout the spring you have classes and other kinds of things that you have down there, right?
Yes, we do have classes. In fact, we will have a citrus class coming up in the not too distant future. Just check our website, www.gonursery.com, to find out when that'll be.
Gonursery.com. And the Great Outdoors, a South Austin institution.
Yes.
And always a fun place to shop, and we appreciate you coming in and sharing all this information. I'm sure they can find all the supplies they need to grow citrus successfully here in the Central Texas area. So thanks very much for being on the show.
Thanks, Tom. Glad to be here.
Coming up next, it's our friend Daphne Richards with Down to Earth.
Hello, and welcome to Down to Earth. Our question this week is what to do about all of those weeds that have taken over our yards this year with all of that winter rain. I think everyone is probably just taken over by weeds, no matter if it's your lawn or your garden beds. My yard happens to be riddled with three weeds: henbit, monstrous gargantuan dandelions, and a little wintry grass, a little grass called winter grass. Most of those weeds are too large for herbicides to do any damage to at this point. If your grass is still dormant, you could possibly use a glyphosate product to kill them, but those large weeds, it really won't make much difference on. So instead, you really need to either hand pull them, which I know will be a huge job, or use something like a weed popper to get those out as much as possible. The ones that you can't get out, the smaller ones other than your dandelions, go ahead and mow those down to remove as many seeds as possible to help keep those weeds from returning. But many of them do return from seeds, and they'll do that next fall, the way they did this fall, and grow through the winter. So you do need to apply a pre-emergent in the fall and spring of next year to keep those under control. Our plant this week is Gazania rigens. And the cultivar I'd like to highlight today is Aztec Orange. There are many different cultivars of this flower, and so choose the one that you like. This plant is small and clumping, but it does also spread to create a ground cover if that's what you would like it to do. It is perennial and sometimes evergreen here in our landscapes, which makes it a nice winter feature. It is native to southern Africa, but it's not invasive here, and it's very easy to find in nurseries. It likes full sun, but it can also take light shade. It does prefer well-drained soil, but it's tolerant of other soils. Just if you have a very heavy clay soil, it would be good to amend your beds to make that a little more water draining. It's also very drought tolerant, but it does like a little more water if you can give it to it just through the hot months of the summer, especially a summer like we had last year. Hopefully we won't have a summer like that again. It does have an underground stem, so you really want to be careful about overwatering this plant because that stem will rot and the crown will die back. The flowers on this plant are bright orange with a deep orange stripe. It does bloom from spring all the way through fall, so it makes it a great plant for us here. Those flowers do close at night and open again the next day. This plant has virtually no insects or diseases, which makes it a very low maintenance plant. And again, I said it's very easy to find in the nurseries. It doesn't require much fertilizer. In fact, I wouldn't fertilize these plants at all. And you do need to space them about 12 inches apart if you want them to clump and be a single flower, and 4 to 6 inches apart if you want them to spread together and be more of a ground cover. To do in your garden this week, it's time to fertilize your roses again. We fertilize those about every 6 weeks, and also you should fertilize your fruit trees at this time. You also need to watch for the reemergence of any dead plants that you might think have died over the winter. Watch for those because they could be coming back for you right about now. We'd love to hear from you. Send us your question or plant of the week from your garden to klru.org/ctg.
Thanks, Daphne. Now let's check in with Trisha Shirey for Backyard Basics.
Homegrown tomatoes are everyone's favorite, but it can be a little bit intimidating when we go to a nursery and there's so many choices out there. So I'm going to help you choose the right plant for your garden. One of the first things that you need to figure out is, do you want a determinate tomato or an indeterminate tomato? Determinate means the size is determined. They'll typically be 30 inches to 36 to 48 inches tall, and that's about it. They tend to put their fruit on all at once, and then they decline. Now, an indeterminate tomato means the size is not determined, and they can easily be 10 to 12 feet long, so they are not ideal for container plants. And they need a very serious cage to keep them supported in the garden. But they do produce a smaller amount of fruit over a longer period of time. Many times your indeterminate tomatoes that you put in March are still performing for you in December, while the determinates will have been long gone. But the determinate tomato is ideal if you're canning or want to go away for the summer and not worry about tomato plants. So I like to plant a little bit of both. But if you are growing in containers, stick with determinate varieties, and there are some determinants that are extra small, like Patio and Goliath, that are going to do well in a smaller container. I'm not a big fan of the upside down planters. Most of those are just way too small for tomatoes, and they get stressed out easily in our heat, so not something that I would choose. Now, the other thing that you'll want to look for are the letters on the labels. Many tomatoes will have letters like V, F, N, and that stands for the particular disease resistance that those tomatoes have been bred for. Now, I have root knot nematodes in my soil at Lake Austin Spa Resort, so I always look for the N, which indicates nematode resistant, so that I'll have a good crop of tomatoes. But you'll want to pay attention to that if you've had disease problems in the past, and avoid buying a tomato that's susceptible to that disease. And I'll have more information about determinate and indeterminate varieties and disease resistance information on our KLRU website for Central Texas Gardener. Now, looking at plants in the nursery, you want to avoid plants that have stunted leaves, yellowish leaves. These leaves could be easily trimmed off, but if the whole plant has leaves that are spotty or yellowing, I'd avoid that plant. Also look for purplish looking leaves and very purple stems. Now, tomatoes have a natural purplish stem near the base, but if the whole stem is purple, maybe it's been damaged by cold and it's going to be stressed. I like to buy in nurseries that have their plants protected in the nighttime, just like I'm going to do when I get them home. Now, this plant has 3 plants per pot, and that is going to be a plant that's a little bit stressed. It's crowded, so I would leave that at the nursery. If it had just one tiny additional plant, you could trim that off easily. Now, this is a nice healthy plant. It doesn't have a lot of roots protruding through the base. If you see really long roots hanging out of the bottom of the pot, it's been in that pot too long. If you see blooms on the plant, it's probably been in that pot too long. So this is a nice healthy plant. I would actually take the lower leaves off and pot this plant up in a container to about this level. And I grow them in a container because tomatoes don't like temperatures below 50 at night. So when you're still getting into that below 50 degree range, I like to have my plants in a container, have them protected in the evening. Some people will put them on a wagon and roll them out of the garage in the daytime and roll them back in at night to protect them. If you've got a greenhouse, that's ideal. But even a covered porch or patio or indoors in the evening, just to protect them, will help you jump ahead with your tomato harvest. The other important factor is that many tomatoes, especially the large fruited tomatoes, don't set fruit well when temperatures get above 90 degrees. So if you're late in putting out your tomatoes and then they have to set blooms and fruit and the temperatures start to get high, those blooms just fall off and you won't get tomato plants. So important to do this step of planting in containers early on. And so when your plants are in the containers, they're allowed to start setting blooms. And even sometimes with container tomatoes, they'll start setting fruit for you in these pots. And when I put them in the ground, I don't go too deep again. So when I put this in the ground, I would plant it at the same level it's been in the container, but I would take off these lower leaves. And that way the plant won't have diseases jumping up into the upper leaves. I also tend to avoid six packs. If you're just planting a few tomatoes, get some diversity in your garden. Don't plant all one species of tomatoes because you just won't have the disease resistance. Try to get those tomatoes hardened off by getting them adapted to being outside before you put them in the garden all at once. These steps will help you be successful with your tomato plants in your own home garden.
Check out klru.org/ctg for more tips, events, and our blog. Next week, spice things up with Asian and Mexican herbs. Until then, I'll see you in the garden.
To learn about today's program, watch online, and follow CTG's blog, check out klru.org/ctg.